Nate Almighty, aka the Global Dark Skin Ambassador. I got a special guest, man. This shit happened organically. This brother reached out to me. He came across my channel on YouTube, man. I realized he doing similar things on his YouTube platform, and I figure, why not share? Why not share? Why not reach out with another real brother and get a couple things done? So I got my brother right here. Tell the people who you are.
Yo, Boom Boom, it's Antonio Bicicleta, Latin Pain, everything from the Bronx, New York.
Latin Pain from the Bronx, New York, another Bronx representative, man. The home of a lot of real shit, man. The home of hip hop. We're gonna get into some rap shit too. But where you from in the Bronx, my brother?
Well, I was born. When I was born, we originally started on 188th and Webster. And then, you know what I'm saying, when my mom's a pop split up, I was like 5'6". I moved to Bethel Park. Then I moved to White Plains Road, Parkside Projects. And I just bounced around the Bronx like my whole life, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, so real Bronx king from the soil. Yeah. Till I moved to South Carolina, I was basically in the Bronx my whole life too. I mean, I did like a summer, like a homeless shelter with my family, or I lived in like Queens or Brooklyn here and there, but basically been the Bronx my whole life, man. The reason why the universe brought us together, I guess, we got similar stories, similar background, you know, Bronx kids, you know, growing up, you know what I'm saying, and poverty to, I guess, you know, mid-level, you know what I'm saying. This guy said he got some Rikers Island stories as well as he make music like me. So what I want to do, bro, is I want to first get a little bit into your background, you know what I'm saying? You could tell as much as you want, you can withhold as much as you want. And I want to ask, you know what I'm saying, for you personally, what was your upbringing like? What was it like growing up in the Bronx? And what led you into the street? Understandably, I would assume that, you know what I'm saying, you changed your life around now. But what led you into the street life, and how was your upbringing coming up?
Well, more or less, we went from 188th to Bethel Park because my mom's and pops, you know what I'm saying, they was in a real toxic relationship, you know what I'm saying? Like, they used to, you know what I'm saying, beat each other up and all kind of craziness, you know what I mean? Like, my pops was a little loose, you know what I mean?
Yeah, be like that.
We bounced, and we moved to Bethel Park. We thought it was going to be better, but it wasn't really that much better. My mom's had married a narcissist. I don't know if y'all familiar with, you know what I'm saying, people with narcissistic personality disorder and all that, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So, I went from 6 years old to 13 years old with that dude, who was pretty abusive, you know what I mean? I started running away when I was 11, you know what I'm saying? Got my little taste of the streets at 11 years old. I started running away, but, you know, I would get caught. They'd bring me back to my family, whatever, you know what I'm saying? And then my mom's left them. When my mom's left them in 92, we moved to Allerton Avenue by Parkside Projects, and I started chilling over there. And I guess that's where everything, you know what I'm saying? That's where I got, like, introduced to criminal activity.
Wait, Allerton... What's that? Two train line?
Yeah, the 2 and the 5.
Yeah.
So we moved out there. Now things was happening before then. It was rocky before then, but you know, I got a good moms, you know what I mean? But by that time, you know, I was kinda I felt maybe as a youth I had a lot of childhood traumas, you know what I'm saying? So I just started playing outside more, you feel me? I started trying to find me around 13, you know what I mean? I hit Allerton Avenue, you know what I'm saying? Shout out to Parkside Projects, you know what I'm saying? Shout out to Gun Hill, you know what I mean? All that area. Started running around up and down. When I was 15, though, when I turned 15, my moms couldn't take me no more. Like, you know, I wasn't going to school. I was getting in the fights. I was just an angry kid. My moms couldn't take me no more. So she sent me to live with my father, with my biological father, who I didn't really know him like that. You know what I'm saying? So I moved to 156 in the concourse, went to Morris High School, and it was just lit, man, from there. You know what I mean? Things just started happening, man. It started to speed up for the kid a little bit. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I agree. You know, yeah, that accelerated lifestyle, you know, similar to me, you know, my mother and my stepfather used to drink a whole lot, and I used to get in the fights with my stepfather and stuff. And 13, 14, I started going outside too, and basically just started getting in the shit, you know what I'm saying? Dealing with the anger, like starting to play the knockout game and shit like that, you know what I'm saying? I'm sure you familiar with some type of knockout game.
Well, you know, I'm a loving creature, you know what I'm saying? By nature, I'm just not soft. Like, I don't, there's a lot of things I don't accept, you know what I mean? So, you know, I stand on what I stand on. But I remember that knockout game thing. We used to call it Johnny. I think I'm a little older than you. But back in the days, I had a son named Frank White. He used to tell crackheads and dope fiends, like, yo, that's Johnny, and point across the street. And if they look, he used to rock them. You know what I'm saying? So I remember that stupid game. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, it's crazy. Stupid. And it's some bully shit. Some corny shit. Like, all the way, man. But, yeah, so yeah, I agree, man. It's similar. It's definitely similar. You said you also spent time on Rikers Island. How much time did you spend on Rikers Island? Did you go up north? Like, what kind of?
I've been to Rikers Island about 4 times in my life. You know what I'm saying? My longest stay on Rikers Island was 8 months. I've been up north twice. My longest stay up north was 3 years. You know what I'm saying?
Okay, yeah, you did.
I've been up north 3 times, actually, pardon me, because I did 2 parole violations.
Oh, yeah. I mean, you did more time than me. I mean, I did a 1-3. I did a 1-3, but I spent basically half of that on Rikers Island. I was, like, on Rikers Island for, like, 19 months. I'm 29. You probably a couple years older than me. So,
man, I got you about a little more than a decade, homie.
Yeah, like, which is why it was interesting for me to reach out to you, because I know how Rikers was when I was there, but I also know that, like, your era was 10 times more dangerous. It was way more drugs going around. It was way more gang violence going around. Way more like knives and shanks and way more illegal activity as far as with the police going on and stuff like that. I always say to the older dudes who've been on Rikers Island that comment under my videos, like, I already know your era was way more dangerous than mine. I mean, when I got there, it's fights all the time, you know, like, yeah, an occasional cutting, an occasional stabbing, but it was mostly just hands. Like, by the time I got there, I realized that a lot of people used to make, like, shanks and stuff from, like, the radiator metals and stuff like that. By the time I got there, a lot of that metal was already gone, and it was straight just like the pipe from the radiator. Because a lot of times, all the materials was gone and stuff like that, and, you know, they not going to replace that just so it can get hectic again, you know what I'm saying? But,
the population back when I was a youth, you know what I'm saying, the population was bigger, you know what I'm saying? First, you know, I'd be watching the news and I'd be, you know what I'm saying, I always kept my eye on it. You know, like, we used to have like 17,000 people on the island, you know what I'm saying? Now it's down to like 7,000, 8,000, you know what I mean? So the population was really heavy back then. You know what I'm saying? They was locking people up. And you had Bronx House, Brooklyn House, you know what I'm saying? You had all these other jail suits where they was overcrowded, man. You know what I'm saying? During the 90s, it was like, man, teenagers was just getting locked up left and right, getting murdered left and right. I lost a lot of friends, you know what I'm saying? To gunplay in the streets. I lost a lot of friends to incarceration, except for getting caught up in the gunplays in the Bronx. Like, the Bronx used to have the murder rate, you know what I'm saying, in the 90s, you know what I mean?
Crazy, yeah, and I remember just, because, like, I'm a 90s baby, but I specifically remember how dangerous it was and how the drugs used to really be bad. Like, you'll walk outside any time of the day, it's dope fiends leaning everywhere, you know what I'm saying, looking like the Thriller video. I remember when the blood shit first started happening, and I remember people used to really not wear red because you could really get hurt just for wearing the color red outside. Like, it got a little bit more safe. Like, I remember my mom used to be like, you're not wearing no red outside. Like,
I remember when it first started too. Like, if you was wearing red, you know what I'm saying, bloods are coming and spit something you never heard of before, G-checking you, you know what I'm saying, to see if you was blood or not. And if you wasn't blood and you was rocking that red, you know, you may be caught up in something you ain't want to be in, you know what I mean? You might get hurt, poked up. The Buck 50 was like the culture, you know what I'm saying? So, you know, we had a lot of dudes. If you look back and look at some of the older brothers, there's a lot of older brothers with Buck 50s, you know what I'm saying? A lot of Buck 50s out there, you know what I mean?
A lot, man. That shit was dangerous. I mean, I guess it kind of changed for the better, but then at the same time, it got worse at the same time, you know what I'm saying? Like, but at least there's some people who came from that and they changed their life and they was able to help save other lives, you know what I'm saying? That's pretty much the positive thing about it. But now, let's get straight into it. I remember you told me, maybe this morning, you told me how you had an altercation with a cop on Rikers Island and you ended up losing a tooth.
Well, no. On Rikers Island, I had an altercation with a cop. That's not where I lost my tooth at. I'll tell you two stories real quick about police brutality in the prisons, right?
Yeah.
So one time I was in a box, you know what I'm saying? I had a fight with another Puerto Rican brother.
You was up north? Raped. You was up north already, or you was on the island?
Now, this first time I was on the island. Okay. You know? So I had an altercation with a Spanish kid who was racist, and my son Papa, he was black, and dude, you know what I'm saying, try to play me like I was a Puerto Rican because I chill with the black kids, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So some kid from Puerto Rico, anyway, I rocked them, and they sent me to the box. So one day in the box, I'm there like 3 days, and they came to my cell and said they was taking me to a psych evaluation, you know? So they shackled me. I'm in GRVC in the Beacon. So they shackled me. They start taking me down to by the clinic or whatever where the psych was at. And they was talking mad greasy to me. They was trying to bully me. You know what I'm saying? Now I'm young. I'm skinny. You know what I'm saying? They thinking, but I'm not sore. I'm telling them, yo, just do your job, fam. You don't even got to talk to me. You know what I mean? So it was Officer Sanchez and Officer Santoro. So when we get to the... right outside the door where the psychiatrist was, they sat me on a yellow chair, and Sanchez left, and Santoro kept, you know what I'm saying, berating me. So I said something back, you know what I'm saying, he ain't like my attitude. He grabbed me by the throat, started choking me, you know?
Yeah.
When he let go of me, I spit at him. So when I spit at him, because I'm shackled, I couldn't do nothing else but spit, you know what I'm saying? So I spit at him because I was angry. And he beat me up, bro. He started punching me in my face. Bing, bing, bing. Well, when he went to punch me, I kicked my feet out. So he fell on top of me. We both fell. And he hit me. Bing, bing, bing. 3 times. The lady in the psychiatrist's office, I guess she heard the commotion. She opened the door. She started screaming like, yo, what you doing? You can't do that. Bunch of police came. They grabbed me, whatever. They gave me an extra 60 days in a box for that. You know what I'm saying? Anyway, that was my first, you know what I'm saying, incident, you know what I'm saying, with police putting their hands on me. You feel me? The second time, though, I was in Fishkill Correctional Facility, and me and a bunch of brothers, we were selling weed and we were selling heroin in the jail. You know what I'm saying? My man used to get it in, and he used to pass me packs, and he, you know what I'm saying? I wasn't really getting set out by my family like that at the time, so I was taking all opportunities to get any hustle on. You feel me? So they interrogated me about it. I clowned them, you know what I'm saying? I was being silly. I was talking smack to the dep, you know what I mean? The head of the goon squad, whatever you call it back then. And New Year's Eve came. This was a couple days before New Year's Eve. So when New Year's Eve came, I had some bud. So I threw a little party in my dormitory. I started spreading love with the other brothers in the chair. And other brothers had bud too. So we started spreading love. I'm throwing baby powder in the air. You know what I mean? I'm doing whatever I want. And 4 o'clock that morning, they snatched 10 of us up, bro. They came. Because they smelled the bug, whatever. They came, they took us off a piss test. I got another 60 days in a box in Fishkill. When I was in a Fishkill box, there's these two officers. One's, they both named as Reposes, a father and a son. So the father worked the daytime, and then when he was leaving, his son would take over. You know what I mean? So one day, the father, he comes to my cell, and you know how up north they give you the green rule books? Well, he tells me, I got a bunch of books underneath my table, so he told me I had to pick them up. But they was neat, but he said they don't belong under the table. So I've opened up the green rule book. I said, yo, it don't say that nowhere in this rule book that I can't do that. You can't make your own rules. You know what I mean? So he didn't like my attitude. So he said, son, we argue. It was the same day. It was shower day, too. But he had let a couple, he had let some inmates out their cell to play chess. He opened my cell, too. But when I came out, he was like, nah, not you. You go back in your cell. Lock in. I'm like, all right, whatever, dog. You know what I mean? I locked in. Anyway, when his shift was over, he leaves. His son comes in. So now, I don't know if you're familiar with Fishkill Box, but in Fishkill, and most, I guess all the boxes that I've ever been to operate pretty much the same. On shower day, they normally start from the first cell to the last cell, or from the last cell to the first cell. You know what I'm saying? And they come to your cell, they cuff you from behind through the slot, and they walk you to the gate, and they throw you in the shower cell, and you take your shower. They ask if you want a razor, they give you the razor through the bars. And this day, they didn't do none of that. This day, on shower day, they just cracked 24, said I was my cell. So I never heard him call no other cell when I was awake. So I looked out, and he's like, he's calling me over. He's like, yo, come there. So I'm like, this is weird. No, this is not how they operate. He not even coming to cuff me. So anyway, I was like, whatever. I came out. So I walked to the shower. My boxes, I got my boxes, my towel. You know what I'm saying? My shower slippers. I walked to the shower. He opened it. He let me in. Officer Reposa. There's two officers on the tier right now. Him and this kid, dude named Lestarge. Anyway, they throw me in the shower. Gave me a razor. They never cuffed me. I take a shower. I shave. When I come out, I'm like, yo, CO, I'm finished. He came and he didn't cuff me again. He just opened it up. So now back then, they used to have a camera on the tier, but there's no camera in the property room. You know what I'm saying? Where they keep all our stuff while we're in the box. So he's like, I got the razor in my hand, son. I could have did whatever I wanted, but I wasn't on that. So when I came out the shower, I'm still not cuffed. I'm thinking that's odd again. I'm like, yo, why they not cuffing me? But whatever. He's like, yo, go in the property room, throw it in the bucket. So he walks me into the property room. They had like a Tootsie Roll bucket where they used to throw the used razors. So when I went to throw the used razor in it, I felt something was going to happen. But when I went to throw the used razor in it, boom, son snuffed me. You heard?
Wait. Why he even had static with you?
I guess his father might have, and his father and the dept, they didn't like my attitude. You know what I'm saying? So I guess they must have had a discussion, you know, that I wasn't there for. Like, yo, we going to set son up. You know what I'm saying? Get him out of here, whatever. I don't know. But this is what happened. I threw the razor in the bucket and got snuffed. Bang. So now he snuffed me, but he didn't really hurt me. He just kind of hurt my pride. You know what I'm saying? So he was a younger officer too. He was probably a little bit older than me. I was 22, you know what I mean, at the time. So when he snuffed me, bang, I moved back and I just got it on with him. I started hemming him up.
So you actually was able to get the one on with him?
Yeah, because I wasn't cuffed. He never cuffed me or none of that. Okay. You know what I'm saying? So I threw the thing in the razor. He hit me. I hit him back. I hit him about four times, bro. And he fell on me. So the other officer runs in the property room. His name is Officer Lestarge.
Wait. Hold on. So he tried to stall off for you and you basically beat him up.
I washed him, my dude. I promised you. So he hit me. I was nice back then. I was about a buck 70, you know what I'm saying? 22 years old, young, you know what I'm saying? Like, I was on my health shit, you know what I'm saying? All I did was eat my potatoes, smoke my butt, and do my workout, you know what I mean? But anyway, when he did that, I rock him, bing, 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 hit about four times. He fell. But the other officer runs in, so we start wrestling. You heard? So while we wrestling, he's trying to grab me. I'm trying to grab him. I slam him on the wall. His glasses fell off. But all I could hear is chains and feet coming from down the tier. So I'm like, oh, here come them boys. You know what I mean? So they already pulled the pin. It was a setup, bro. They pulled the pin before I even got into the property room, it feels like. You know what I mean? So I'm still wrestling with Officer Lestarge when like five more officers run into the property room and start putting the beats on me, bro. They beat me for a minute. You know what I'm saying? So they trying to cuff me. I'm trying not to let them. I'm trying to fight back, but I ain't had no wins. You know what I mean? It's a bunch of big white boys.
Yeah, that's what they do, man. Once They gonna jump on your ass. They do that shit wherever police is at.
So people, they stomping me out, bro. They stomp my liver. They stomp. They kicking me in the kidney. They kicking me in my nuts. Like, they just stomping me out on the floor. I'm thinking I'm about to die, son. I ain't even gonna lie. I'm like, yep, they gonna kill me here. So they stomping me out, and then they cuff me. Right, they finally get to cuff me because I was resisting the cuffs. You know what I'm saying? So they finally cuff me. They stand me up. They holding me on two sides. The ward, what you call it up north, bro? The deck. The captain, whatever, the head of the
Ain't it like a squad. Sergeant? Like a sergeant?
Yeah, the ones with the white shirts. So he come in, the one that I disrespected during the interrogation about the drugs, because they tried to interrogate me. The one I disrespected, he comes in, so he's like, yo, what happened? He came in last. So I'm cuffed. Now, this is a big white boy. He kind of brolic, too. So he runs in. He's like, yo, what happened? So the officer reposer, he's exaggerating. He's still on the floor. He could have got up, but he's trying to make it look good. You know what I'm saying? So he's still on the floor when his boss comes in. And the boss is like, yo, what happened? So officer reposer's like, yo, this inmate got out the shower and assaulted me. But that's not what happened. You know what I'm saying? Y'all let me out with no cuffs. And you hit me. But anyway, so he's lying. So the captain, he's like, oh, you want to hit my officers? And boom, he rocked me in my face, bro. You hear me? Yo, he hit me so hard. I saw five of this nigga, bro. You hear me? Excuse my language. I saw five of him. So I'm dizzy. I'm super dizzy, right?
Oh, I get it. So that's why he didn't cuff you. So in worst case scenario, when a high authority came, he could say that this inmate assaulted me.
Exactly. So the captain rocks me. I see five of him. Then he's talking to me, but I can't hear him because all I can hear is the ringing in my ears. You know what I'm saying? My ears is super ringing. So he's talking, I don't know. Then I see three of him. He start merging. I'm standing there for a little minute, and I'm choking on something. Bro, I'm choking on my tooth, bro. Yeah. So I coughed it up on my tongue, and I felt it. I swiveled it around. I'm angry, bro. I'm like, wow, yo, I had mad fights in my life. Nobody ever knocked my tooth out. You know what I mean? So I'm mad. So he's talking still, and I swiveled the tooth around my mouth, and then I spit it at him. It hit him in the cheek. When I hit him in the cheek, he was like, you mother effer. And boom, he gut shot me. You heard? I lost all my air, son. This dude hit hard. You hear me? This dude hit hard, hard, hard. So he hit me in my solar plex, basically, and I couldn't breathe. So I'm like, oh, I'ma die. Anyway, I didn't die. I'm here talking to you. But they picked me up by my arms and they threw me in the cell. So now I'm on the floor cuffed in my cell. I'm hurting, bro. And a couple of minutes later, they let me lay on the floor for like 5 minutes, bro. They came back. They was like, yo, give us those cuffs. So I get up. It was hard to get up, too, because I ain't had no hands. You know what I mean? I had to slide to the wall and use the wall to help me prop myself up, and I was hurt. So I give them, when I put my hands through the slots, they squeeze the cuffs tighter. I'm like, oh, man, these dudes don't stop. Anyway, they leave. They take the cuffs off, they leave. Then that captain dude comes back. He's like, yo, we got to take you to the infirmary. Now in Fishkill box, when you go from the Fishkill box to the clinic thing, you gotta walk in this little tunnel thing. So I didn't wanna walk in there with them, cause I was like, yo, they gonna wash me up some more. And I'm already in pain. My eyes closing, my lip is swollen, my whole body hurt. You know what I'm saying? So I'm like, nah, I ain't going in there. I refused it. I was like, nah, I refuse the clinic. I ain't going with y'all nowhere. So he was like, basically, he told me, you got two choices. You either cuff up and let's go, cause I had got dressed by this point too. But he was like, you either cuff up and let's go, or we coming in there to get you. So I was like, you just gonna have to come in here and get me, bro. Y'all already trying to kill me. You know what I'm saying? So he leaves. So when he leaves, I rolled up the mattress and I ripped up the sheet and I tied it around the mat. I tried to make like a shield. It didn't work, but I was like, you know, in fear for my life a little bit. You know what I mean? So I figured if I make the shield with the thing, I could probably try to run out and get some hits off or something. You know what I mean? Because I didn't want to go out like that. So they leave. I made a shit out the mattress. I tied up the I made like ropes out the sheet, and I tied the mattress together like a circle. You know what I'm saying? Roped up, and they came back. He's like, crack 24 cell. When they cracked it, they ran in there. I threw the mattress up, but it didn't work. There were so many of them, they got me. So they beat me up a little bit more, but they didn't do too much that time. They just wanted to cuff me, so they cuffed me. And then they passed me off to this other officer who wasn't there the whole time until now, right? But I heard he was a bully. They passed me off to, like, the meanest officer in Fishkill, but he wasn't mean to me. When we got in the tunnel, he's like, yo, I should knock you out. I should knock you out. I'm like, come on, man. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm already washed up. So I'm like, damn, and I'm cuffed. I'm thinking he gonna hit me. But he said, you know what? I'm not gonna knock you out. So I'm like, why? So he said, the other over, he said, Raposa is a B-I-T-C-H. You know what I'm saying? He was like, yeah, Raposa is a dude. You know what I mean? So I was like, oh, he don't even like the other officer neither. You feel me? So he got me to the clinic. When we got to the clinic, there was this older black nurse, this older lady. She was beautiful too, mad pretty. She looked like, she was like Pam Grier, son, you heard?
Yeah, she was nice.
She was beautiful. But she saw me, and my eye kept starting to close and close. I had a, you know, my whole eye was closed, bro. Anyway, when she saw me, she was like, oh my God, honey, what happened? Yo, they trying to kill you? I'm like, yo, look, man, they just beat the flames. I mean, so she knew the officer that escorted me there. But we in the room by ourselves, it's just me and her in this little room, while she's talking to me and she's checking me. She's like, oh my goodness. So she saw, you know, scratches and bruises and all over my body. So she's like, yo, I'm gonna get you out of here, sweetheart. I'm like, I don't know how you're gonna do that, though. She's like, you're gonna do everything I say. I'm like, all right, I agree. She said, you suicidal. But I wasn't suicidal. You know what I mean? But she was like, yo, you suicidal. I'm like, I'm not. She's like, yo, you want to do what I... She said, you suicidal right now because I said so. So she called the other officer, and she barking on the officer because she knew him. But he's like, yo, listen, honey, I wasn't even part of that one. And it was true. He wasn't part of that. You know what I mean? And he didn't like what they did to me neither. So he was like, nah, I wasn't part of that. Uh-huh. So she wrote up a story that I said that I was suicidal, depressed, and all that. And she made me sign it. They sent me to the psychiatrics. When they sent me to the psychiatrics, they took all my clothes. They left me in a suicide watch for 3 days, butt naked, bro, with no mattress, no bed sheets. You know what I'm saying? And they just give you a paper robe and some happy slippers. I don't know why the slippers have happy faces on them. I don't know why. Maybe because your head's supposed to be down. You look at your feet, you start smiling. I don't know. But they leave me in there 3 days. But on the second day, that death dude came, and he did the tear hearing right outside my cell, right outside the suicide thing. They gave me a year in a box on top of the 60 days I was halfway into. You know what I'm saying? So,
wow.
They beat the flames out of me. Then they charged me with assault on police, which was a lie. He really assaulted me. I mean, I hit him back, but he set it off. You know what I mean?
Crazy. All right, so, wait. Hold on, my brother. My bad, but I probably got like 2 minutes left. 2 minutes left. That was a good couple stories. I got about 2 minutes left before this shit shut off. I want you to take the opportunity to plug your music and tell the people your socials before this is over.
More or less, man, you can find me on YouTube at Real Life Real Spit with Latin Pain. You know what I mean? So you can find me on Instagram at Wounded Empathetic Thoughts. You know what I mean? And you can find me on Twitter at Latin Pain. Well, and anything else after that, man, just Google Latin Pain, man. It's mad music on the internet. It's mad music online. So, yeah, man, check me out, bro, for real. And big shout out to you, B, for real, man.
Thank you, brother. Thank you, brother. I'm gonna call you again another time, and we gonna get some more. We gonna chop it up some more, brother. I appreciate you doing this for me.
It's all love, kid. Let's get it.
Peace.